Contact us to avail the combo offer of General Studies and Public Administration optional with 20% discount.
Good morning, sir.
Yes, good morning. Good morning. Yes, because of some technical glitches, we got late here. Yes, let us continue today's lecture. We are going to do the Hindu analysis of 11th July and 12th July together now. Okay, Sunday's newspaper, yesterday's and today's. So these are the important articles. You can see we have enlisted them relevant to our mains examination and prelims examination. Accordingly, the page number and date is mentioned here. So it will be useful for you whenever you are going to make notes after that. So you can understand on which page this article appeared. So let us take overview of all these articles first. First, yesterday's articles for mains purpose. What makes UPA so stringent? See, on Sunday's newspaper, always remember that FAQ page, page number 12 and 11th page, science and technology page. These two are very, very important pages for our examination purpose, because many times directly relevant to our syllabus, the articles appears. Along with that, you also need to understand that if you skip any issue from the previous, let's say 1 week, to have follow up on that particular issue. Suppose in last 1 week we have discussed many articles on UPA. Let's say because there was death of Father Stan Swamy, and because of that many editorial, many articles appeared. So if you have missed on having the follow up on those issues, all the issue is, or the, let's say, basic information about that issue will be discussed on FAQ page. Will be discussed on FAQ page on that same article here. Okay, so if you miss on any particular article, try to have a read that article. So here again we will have revision here on Unlawful Activities Prevention Act, this 1967. So which are these provisions which make it so stringent here? So polity perspective and GS3 paper security part also. Then, don't reveal identity in sexual offences cases. Supreme Court has advised the lower judiciary, including high courts and subordinate judiciary. Okay, so which particular section of IPC prohibits the disclosure of the victims in sexual offences? That particular section, along with that particular judgment of Supreme Court, which says that the identity should not be revealed in sexual offences of particular victim. Okay. So this is important from Polity and Social Justice GS2 paper. Then, can schools be reopened during the pandemic? Again, on page number 11, Science and Tech page. So it is talking about whether schools should be opened or not during this COVID-19 pandemic times. And if they are opened, what measures should be taken to ensure the safety of the children, teachers and all environment in the school? Okay, so that becomes important from governance and COVID-19 perspective here. And lastly, India hands over relics to Georgia. So here, one of the queen of Georgia, 17th century relics, which were found in 2017, we can say in Goa. So those relics are now handed over to the Georgian government. Okay, so how it helps in building the bilateral relations between India and Georgia, along with that, the location of that country. Whenever any, let's say, bilateral visit of our heads of the government, if Prime Minister, President or Ministry of External Affairs, they are visiting any country, you should be always looking in the atlas, the location of that country and particular features if they are. Then along in, let's say, whether it is bordering any important ocean or sea, all this is important here, okay, from geography perspective. Now from today's The Hindu newspaper, the editorial, cooperative spirit, GS2 paper, polity part. In last week, we have seen that the new union ministry is formed, cooperation ministry. Okay, so regarding that context, the article is written here. So here we will look into what are cooperatives, the principles on which they work, what are the advantages, in which areas the cooperatives have flourished in India. Along with that, what are the problems, issues faced by the cooperatives and the way forward. Okay. Now, specifically prelims related articles, There was one more article in today's The Hindu newspaper on page number 7, op-ed page, but that again talks about demographic dividend. Yesterday, 11th July was World Population Day. So that's why the article having the context of demographic dividend. But in last week, the similar article we discussed regarding harnessing the demographic dividend. And that's why we'll not repeat that. This is how we have to reduce our burden from reading so many repeating articles and same kind of inputs that we will have from these articles. So we will save our time, we will save our efforts by eliminating such articles, because you are going to have this current affairs for almost 18 months from now onwards, foundation batch students. So that's why you should be aware about what to read and what not to read. Okay. Now, specifically prelims related articles from yesterday's newspaper, largely they are from yesterday's newspaper. You can see Sikkim blossoms, state home to 27% of India's flowering plants. On first page, bottom part of the first page, there is article and it has mention about the biodiversity of Sikkim. It also mentions about Kanchenjunga Biosphere Reserve in Sikkim. It also, let's say, have mentioned about how there is a different kind of altitudinal biodiversity in Kanchenjunga Biosphere Reserve. So that is important, because already question was asked in prelims examination regarding this. And for revision purpose, Biosphere Reserves of India, their locations and total 18 biosphere reserves, and 11 of them included in UNESCO's Man and Biosphere program. Okay, yes. Next, Kaveri and Row Over Mekedetu project. Again, there is repetition. In last to last week, we have looked into this particular project location from geography aspect, across which river the Mekedetu project is being built in Karnataka. Along with that, the other dams across that particular South Indian river. Okay, so from geography perspective, we have to take input here. There is one article on page number 12. This is FAQ page. Okay, so it is talking about what is the conflict that is going on between Karnataka and Tamil Nadu regarding this Mekedatu project. Next, Great Indian Bustard. So on page number 3 of magazine page, the supplement in Sunday's newspaper. Okay, so many such articles having reference to environment section regarding conservation of particular species, especially art and culture related articles appear on magazine newspaper, and book reviews are also there. So if it is relevant to our examination, from time to time we will take input here. But one cover story is there on page number 3 regarding Great Indian Bustard in Rajasthan. Okay, so basic information about Great Indian Bustard, because already many times question was asked in prelims examination regarding conservation of this critically endangered species. Then today's The Hindu newspaper, Richard Branson takes off first in the space tourism race. Science and technology perspective, space science. So space tourism is going to be the next tourism area. And this is the first initiative taken by Richard Branson and his private company. They have, let's say, including Richard Branson and other 5 astronauts, or we can say people, they entered into the space. They reached up to 85 kilometer and they came back to the space Earth surface successfully. So this is going to launch the new era into the space tourism now. Okay, so that becomes important from space science perspective. GS3 paper, there is science and technology part in mains examination also. Along with that, for prelims examination, some basic information will have. And lastly, Kanwar Yatra on page number 1, it is talking about the decision is not yet taken by Uttarakhand Chief Minister regarding Kanwar Yatra. So from culture aspect, different kind of festivals, traditions, we have to know about them. Okay, so that becomes important from culture perspective. We'll take input here. And lastly, COVID-19 related developments at national and international stage, and practice prelims MCQs from today's current affairs. Let us go into details of all these articles one by one. What makes UPA so stringent? Yes, this will be some kind of revision to you, but yes, that becomes important. All information in one place. Okay, yes. What is origin of UPA? As we can understand, the death of Father Stan Swamy, tribal rights activist, last week, that has, let's say, resulted into some kind of criticism regarding this UPA and stringent provisions under this act. Now, origin of UPA, 1967, in which this act was passed by the parliament. Basically, we have to understand during 1960s or even immediately after independence and during 1960s, there was growing secessionist activities in different parts of the country, be it Northeast India or Northwest India, like Jammu Kashmir, Punjab region, or Northeastern India, many secessionist tendencies were there. And therefore, to ensure the sovereignty of the country and maintain the integrity of the country, some of the stringent laws, provisions were felt required at that time, and the urgency was given by Naxal Bari movement, which started in 1967 itself. Okay, Naxal Bari movement, the peasant movement, to some extent violent movement that started in Naxal Bari village in West Bengal. Today we are witnessing the expansion of this movement into left-wing extremism, which is again important part of our security GS3 paper, internal security part. Okay, so yes, that provided the urgency to pass this UPA Act in 1967. Okay, so under this UPA, many provisions were added here. They were regarding protecting the sovereignty of the country, integrity of the country, declaring many such associations and unions which have some kind of secessionist tendencies, and therefore they are declared or they are banned under this UPA Act. Okay, what is the scope and how has it been expanded over the years? Yes, scope means that under this particular act, many such associations, organizations which have tendency of secessionist tendency or which have impact on sovereignty and integrity of the country, they are banned under this UPA Act. Now, over the years, it has, let's say, been expanded through amendments in 2004, 2013 and 2019. Okay, so from time to time, the act has been amended. For example, in 2004, we know that the earlier acts like POTA and TADA Act, they were repealed. TADA Act was repealed, and therefore, through this 2004 amendment, the terrorist activities were controlled, and ban on terrorist organizations, all these provisions were included in UPA itself. Okay, along with that, many such United Nations Security Council or UN conventions and those provisions were added in 2004 amendment. Now, in 2019, recently, the designation of terrorists, who are the terrorists, and declaring particular person or individual as a terrorist, that definition is expanded through 2019 amendment. There was one question in 2019 mains examination regarding this UPA Amendment Act along with that NIA Amendment Act. Okay, so regarding security part, internal security part, GS3 paper. Okay, so in this manner, the scope of this UPA Act was expanded subsequently through amendments in 2004, 2013 and 2019. Now, how do UPA provisions differ from regular criminal law? Now, this is very important. Under this regular criminal law, or we can say criminal procedure code is there, and UPA. Yes. So, stringent provisions are under UPA. For example, if we are talking about the remand provision. So, under criminal law, it provides for maximum 15 days remand can be given, but here
30 days remand can be given to a particular person. If you are talking about judicial custody, then under normal criminal law, we can say that judicial custody is maximum of 90 days. But under UPA, it can be extended to 180 days. It can be extended to 180 days. Then bail provisions. So here, not stringent, but here stringent provisions are there, and therefore bail cannot be given easily when the provisions under UPA Act are invoked. These are actually the differences. That's why we have to understand the stringent provisions. What is the controversy about the bail provisions? So we have to understand the present context. Many such rights activists have been arrested, especially regarding the Elgar Parishad and the Bhima Koregaon violence that happened. So the bail has been denied to these activists and they are still under arrest. So that's why it is largely contested. Section 43D5 of this particular UPA Act, it provides for stringent bail provisions. Okay, so that means the judge who is going to look into the bail application, that judge is supposed to accept the allegations against that person prima facie true. Okay, that means there is no requirement to go into details about the allegations to understand that whether they are true or not. That means it depends on the person against whom the allegations are done to prove those allegations false. Okay, so this is to some extent very harsh provision regarding the bail. Okay, that's why the bail has been denied from time to time, even by the high courts also. Okay, so you should be aware about some factual information. If you mention such numbers of the sections, it has some kind of, let's say, additional advantage in your answers in mains examination. Okay, so this you will be able to write after many such revisions. Section 43D5. Fine. So yes, these are the provisions. Now, Unlawful Activities Prevention Act goes against the fundamental rights of the people and therefore it needs appropriate amendments. Comment. We can expect such kind of question in GS2 paper. Why we can say that it goes against the fundamental rights of the people? First thing we have to understand, fundamental rights we are talking about Article 19, Article, we can say 20, Article 21, Article 22. Okay, so yes, Article 19, freedom of speech and expression, then Article 20, rights against, we can say, offenses or arrest. Article 21, it talks about right to life and personal liberty, right to life with dignity. Here it talks about punitive and preventive detention, and the rights of the people under punitive and preventive detention. Okay, so you should be aware about which rights are concerned here when we are saying that. Then along with that, you can also write about Article 14, equality before law, equal protection of law. Okay, equality rights under Article 14. So how they are impinged because of UPA Act, those provisions you can mention in this answer like this. Fine, any question regarding this article? Yes. Next, don't reveal identity in sexual offences cases. Supreme Court. Now, Supreme Court has asked the lower judiciary, trial judges, to take care of not revealing the identity of victims in sexual offences cases. Now, which provision under IPC? Section 228A of Indian Penal Code prohibits publication of the identity of victims in sexual offences cases. Okay. So, yes, Supreme Court in state of Karnataka versus Putta Raja case. Putta Raja case is different from Putta Swami case. Putta Swami case relates to right to privacy. Okay. Putta Raja case is different. Now, in this particular case, Supreme Court has said that keeping in view the social object of preventing social victimization or ostracism of the victim of sexual offense for which this section 28A has been enacted, it would be appropriate that judgments, be it of this court, that is Supreme Court, High Court or lower court, the name of the victim should not be indicated. We have chosen to describe her as victim in this judgment, the Supreme Court has said. That means we have to understand that the victim is actually, when the name of the victim, identity of the victim is revealed in sexual offenses, there is some kind of social victimization even after the judgment for many such years happen. We know that our society is like that only, and to prevent that social victimization, the Supreme Court has taken this particular decision. Along with that, our law in IPC itself, section 228 provides for not revealing the identity of the sexual offences victims. Okay. So, you should be aware about the social justice part, vulnerable sections of the society, along with that criminal justice system, which is also part of Polity GS2 paper. Okay? Yes. Now, moving on to next article. Can schools be reopened during the pandemic? So, yes, we have to understand that since last 1 year, the schools have been shut down because of pandemic, and therefore it is affecting the learning process, educational outcomes. At the same time, it is also affecting the mental health of the students, and therefore many states are now focusing on opening the schools, but that too with safety measures in place. Now, what kind of safety measures are required to be in place? Stringent adherence to universal masking for staff and students, matched by hand hygiene, physical distancing, adequate ventilation. Use these words in your answer if the question is talking about the school's opening. Classroom routines redesigned to the limit students' interaction inside and outside the classrooms. There should not be much interaction among the children. Then, high levels of testing and contact tracing within the schools. Vaccination of teachers and other school staff should be prioritized. The level of community transmission in a district should be key parameter to guide the school reopening. That means the decentralized level decisions should be taken at district level. If that particular district is having more number of, let's say, high level of transmission rate and more number of infection cases, then the school should not be reopened in that particular district. These points can be mentioned when we are talking that when schools should be opened and when schools should not be opened. Fine? Okay. Now, India hands over relics to Georgia, relics of Saint Queen Ketevan. Okay, Saint Queen Ketevan. Actually, we have to understand that Saint Queen Ketevan was 17th century Georgian queen. Her relics were found in 2005 at Saint Augustine Convent in Old Goa. Okay, and after that, now the relics have been handed over to the Georgian government. Now, this is described as historical objects as bridge of faith between two countries. This is how our external affairs minister talks about this. Bridge of faith between two countries, the historical objects. Okay, along with that, we have to understand the 2-day visit of external affairs minister to Georgia, which is strategically important country situated at the intersection of Eastern Europe and Western Asia. Eastern Europe and Western Asia. Now, I want every one of you to open your atlas and look at the position, location of Georgia. Okay, political map of Europe, you can open that and you can see the location of Georgia. And I want you to locate the bordering nations. Along with that, in physical map, I want you to tell me which mountain ranges passes through Georgia and which sea is adjoining to Georgia. Tell me. Yes, which mountain ranges passes through Georgia and that region? Physical map. Can we see Caucasus Mountains like this? Greater Caucasus, Lesser Caucasus Mountains, between Black Sea and Caspian Sea, the land which is present between Black Sea and Caspian Sea. Can you locate that? Can you locate Caucasus Mountains? Yes. Now, the Georgia is adjoining which sea, having border with which sea? Okay, Black Sea and Caspian Sea. Whether it is having the border with Caspian Sea?
No, sir.
Yes, only Black Sea. Only Black Sea. You can see the Azerbaijan is having the border with Caspian Sea on this side, and on northern side there is Russia, and then there are Central Asian nations on that side, and then there is Iran on the southern side. Okay. Now, you can see the location of different adjoining countries: Russia, Azerbaijan, Armenia, Turkey. Russia, Azerbaijan, Armenia, Turkey. Okay. So, how to remember this? You can remember like RAAT, R-A-A-T. And how do we know RAAT? As Andhera, blackness. And that's why Black Sea. It is adjoining to Black Sea. You can relate anything. You can create your own innovative things to remember the things, because our mind is not able to remember that much information unless and until we create some shortcuts in our mind. Okay. So, yes, as Georgia is in news, we should remember the location, we should remember the mountain ranges. Caucasus, Greater Caucasus Mountains passes through Georgia, northern side you can see here. Then Black Sea adjoining, and northern side Russia, southern side Turkey, Armenia and Azerbaijan is there. Last year there was conflict between Azerbaijan and Armenia. Azerbaijan, the Muslim majority country, Armenia, the Christian majority country, and there was conflict over Nagorno-Karabakh region. Nagorno-Karabakh region. Between these two countries, Armenia and Azerbaijan. Okay, so that's why it was in news last year, I'm telling you. Okay, so you should be aware about all these developments in nearby region. Fine, that much information is sufficient. Now, moving on, cooperative spirit. This particular editorial on page number 6, it is talking about the new cooperation ministry at union level is created. Now, what are cooperatives and in which areas they are dominant in India? First of all, cooperatives. Cooperatives are associations, or we can say voluntary associations, whenever, let's suppose 3-4 people or group of people having the common interest, common objective, common pursuit in certain area, they come together and form an association. They form an association which works on the principle of first thing, one member, one vote. One member, one vote. Equitable distribution of profits. And you should understand that the cooperatives does not work on the sole basis or objective of profit. Rather, they focus on equitable distribution of profits. Okay, so we have to understand that the shares, like we see in private sector, in private company, what we can see here that a particular individual or particular, let's say, family owns a huge amount of stakes in particular company, right? And the remaining stake are, let's say, in the hands of different stakeholders. But here, cooperative is one member, one vote, and one stake value in that cooperative. This is how the equitable distribution is there. Even in the management of cooperatives, the value of one vote is given to each and every member of that cooperative. And this is how the decisions are taken on the basis of majority in cooperatives. Okay, so these are the principles, these are voluntary associations, and then they are registered under different acts of state government. And we have to understand that these cooperatives have been very, very important in certain sectors of our economy. For example, first of all, we can talk about the farmers, or we can say agriculture. Okay, in agriculture sector, in dairy sector, then in, let's say, sugar industry, textile sector, right, or other such sectors, especially we can also say that credit, rural credit especially. Cooperative sector has grown into manifolds in agriculture, dairy, fertilizers, like IFFCO. Now, IFFCO is the fertilizer cooperative in India, which is having the 1/3 share of the market. We have seen Amul in dairy sector. Amul is cooperative actually. So, it has grown into multi-state cooperative. There are many such sugar industries, cooperatives, and yes, from time to time, these cooperatives have been helpful in development of that sector. The government is able to provide the credit to this sector, these organizations, cooperative organizations, on subsidized rate. Why? Because they are working in rural areas and they are helping in prosperity of rural sector or rural areas. Okay, it helps in poverty elimination, it helps in employment generation and infrastructure development in rural areas. We can understand wherever the Amul cooperatives in Gujarat has developed, you can see the development in rural sector in Gujarat. Okay, so this is how they are helpful, especially also rural credit, because commercial banks, they do not have that many branches in rural areas. They are developed and spread only in urban areas. So rural credit and its disbursement, that becomes important, and cooperatives are very much spread, developed in credit sector also. Yes, principles we have understood. What are the issues faced by them? Yes, issues faced by them, let me enlist them. First of all, that there is mismanagement, or we can say lack of professional management. Lack of professional management. What happens because of mismanagement or lack of professional management? The resources which are available with them, they are not used efficiently. And therefore, we can say that whatever the credit they are receiving or the profit they are generating, that is not being multiplied. That is not being multiplied because of weak, inefficient, mismanagement here. Second thing, there is continuous bureaucratic and political interference. In cooperatives. So, yes, there are cooperatives, elections to different cooperatives, organizations, but from time to time, local politicians and politics, they influence these elections, and in thereby the further cooperative decisions of the management. Okay, so this is actually the major problem and the concern also now. The central government, by forming cooperation ministry, that should not result into politicization of cooperatives. That should not result into politicization of, we can say, cooperatives. Third thing is that the lack of active participation of members in management. Okay, because if I am becoming the member of cooperative, I should be participating in the management. But what happens in cooperatives, the active participation is very limited in the management, and that's why the decisions are not inclusive. Okay, so they are not inclusive, or we can say after wide consultation of the members. This is also the problem. And then you can also say that their success is limited to certain sectors only. Certain sectors only in India. So that's why we have to explore. So basically, this formation of new ministry, this can be used as an advantage. In way forward, you can mention this ministry can be used as an advantage to overcome these issues. And the central government, first thing you have to understand that the cooperation is mentioned in state list in Indian constitution. This is mentioned in state list in Indian constitution. It is not in union or concurrent list. This is domain of state list, and that's why central government will not be able to legislate on this particular subject. But we have to understand that after, let's say, 97th Constitutional Amendment Act, M. Lakshmikant, you can refer to this, cooperatives as a separate chapter has been added in M. Lakshmikant book, latest edition. 97th Constitutional Amendment Act, 2011, it has changed the fundamental rights part of, or we can say part 3 of Indian Constitution, and made under Article 19, fundamental right to form cooperative. It has been made a fundamental right of Indian citizens to form a cooperative organization. Okay, next, DPSPs, that is part 4 of Indian Constitution, this has been amended. And in this part 4, Article 43B has been added and mentioned that state should endeavor to promote the formation of cooperatives and their working. Okay, so this is now responsibility of the state. And new part 9B is added with the heading of cooperatives in Indian Constitution and their workings, all the provisions are mentioned in this part 9B of Indian Constitution. This is important information for prelims examination. Again, I'm repeating, this is very important for prelims examination. Fine? Okay. Now, moving on to next article. Sikkim blossoms, state home to 27% of India's flowering plants. One of the publication of Botanical Survey of India, it is talking about the biodiversity, that is plant biodiversity in Sikkim state. 27% of flowering plants found in India are limited to Sikkim. So this shows the biodiversity of Sikkim. Now, the state which is part of Kanchenjunga Biosphere Reserve has different altitudinal ecosystems. Now, different altitudinal ecosystem, that means it has tropical ecosystem, temperate ecosystem, as well as subalpine, and we can say very high altitudinal ecosystem also. In one biosphere reserve itself, the altitude ranging from or elevation from 300 meters to 8598 meters. Such kind of, let's say, variations in altitude are available in the limited location, and that provides the area, or we can say climatic conditions, for growth of different varieties of plants, as well as they host different varieties of animals also, flora, fauna. Okay, so you should be aware that Kanchenjunga Biosphere Reserve is that kind of biosphere reserve at that national park. Now, there was one question in prelims examination, same question. Which of the following national park is having the different kind of ecosystem, altitudinal ecosystem, that is tropical, temperate, as well as subalpine? Okay, so that means there should be such variations in altitude for having these different kinds of vegetations. Because latitude wise, there is no such national park. Latitude wise, there is no such national park. So that should be altitude wise. And therefore, when there is low altitude, surely there will be tropical vegetation. Then higher altitude, then temperate vegetation. Because temperatures are dropping as we are moving up in the altitude. So this is the biosphere reserve or national park in Sikkim. So more information, this was, let's say, included as a World Heritage Site in UNESCO Heritage Site list in 2016, and the first mixed heritage site in India under this list. This is important for prelims examination again. There are, let's say, different sites that are included with different nomenclature, like natural sites, or we can say that heritage site in terms of heritage also, cultural heritage, natural heritage, and mixed heritage. Different lists are maintained under UNESCO World Heritage Sites. And it has become the first site under mixed heritage. So, specific information. Also, it is, let's say, under Man and Biosphere Program, it is important biosphere reserve included in UNESCO's Man and Biosphere Program. There are total 11 such biosphere reserves in India included in UNESCO's Man and Biosphere Program. And yes, few Lepcha tribes settlements are there. Lepcha tribes are, let's say, indigenous to Sikkim state. Okay, Lepchas. So you should be aware about this. Sikkim Lepcha tribes. Now, for revision purpose, locations, names of different biosphere reserves in one map itself, including those included in World, let's say, Man and Biosphere Reserve Program of UNESCO. There are total 11. Those marked in red, they are included in UNESCO's Man and Biosphere Program. Remaining are not. From top to bottom, let me enlist them. First of all, those included in the we can say Man and Biosphere Program: Nanda Devi in Uttarakhand, Kanchenjunga in Sikkim, Nokrek in Meghalaya, Sundarbans in West Bengal, Simlipal in Odisha, Amarkantak Achanak Mar, both in Madhya Pradesh and Chhattisgarh, on the border region. Then Panchmari in Madhya Pradesh. Then we have Nilgiri at the border of three states, Karnataka, Tamil Nadu, Kerala. Agastya Malai at the border of two states, Kerala and Tamil Nadu. Then we have lastly Gulf of Mannar, the oceanic system, marine system. Okay. And then in Andaman and Nicobar, Great Nicobar Biosphere Reserve. Great Nicobar Biosphere Reserve. Okay, so these are 11. First to be included was Nilgiri and latest in 2018, Kanchanjunga. Just now we have seen this. Okay, remaining national parks are cold desert, Ladakh region as well as part of Himachal Pradesh. Then we have Dihang Dibang in Arunachal Pradesh, Dibru Shikoa in Assam, Manas is in Assam. Then Panna Biosphere Reserve in MP, Run of Kutch in Gujarat, Sechachalam Hills in Andhra Pradesh. Sechachalam Hills in Andhra Pradesh. So these are the remaining biosphere reserve. Total 18, 11 included in UNESCO, remaining are not. 71. Fine? Okay. Now, Kaveri and the row over Mekadetu project. Recently, the Karnataka CM has said that they will continue with this project, and again the Tamil Nadu government has requested central government to not provide the environment clearance by the central government for this project. So that's why it is in news. Now about this project, first of all, location. You can see the location is just along the border between Karnataka and Tamil Nadu, but within the border of Karnataka, 4 kilometers from the border. 4 kilometers from the border. It is being built across the Kaveri River. It is having the twin objective. First, providing drinking water supply to Bangalore and nearby urban areas. And second is hydroelectricity plant. Okay, Kaveri River. So, reservoir construction, hydropower plant of 400 megawatt. Okay, so yes. It has received approval from Union Water Resources Ministry, but the pending approval from Environment Ministry for environment clearance. Okay, along with that, some environmental concerns, like it is going to submerge 63% of the forest area that will be submerged in the Kaveri Wildlife Sanctuary. Kaveri Wildlife Sanctuary. Okay, so you should be aware about that. One additional information that you should be aware is, which are the other dams across Kaveri River. Dams across Kaveri River. In Karnataka, very important, Krishna Raja Sagar Dam across Kaveri River. And in Tamil Nadu, Mettur Dam, then Upper Anaikat Dam and Kallanai Dam. Okay, these are three dams across Kaveri River in Tamil Nadu. You should be aware about the dam's location, different states and rivers. Fine? Okay. Great Indian Bustard. There is cover story in magazine supplement, yesterday's newspaper. So basic information, because last year's prelims examination, there was one question regarding conservation area, protection area of Great Indian Bustard, Desert National Park. Okay. So, concentrated population at present is there in Desert National Park in Rajasthan, spread over two districts, Jaisalmer and Barmer. One of the statement in the question in UPSC in that paper was regarding these two districts, like this only. It is spread over two districts of Rajasthan. Okay, so you should be aware about that also, detailed information. Now, what are the threats? Loss of habitat due to increase in population, agriculture, collision with electricity transmission lines. Actually, this is the context of that cover story, that these birds, being very heavy in weight, they are not able to fly in the upper heights. They fly in the lower, let's say, heights, and that's why they continuously collide with electricity lines. So there is case that there should be underground laying of these electricity lines. Now, stray dogs attack great bustards, eggs and younger ones, poaching outside the protected areas. Now, conservation status, this becomes important. IUCN Red Data Book, critically endangered status. Okay, then along with that, highest protection under Wildlife Protection Act 1972, Schedule 1 species. Appendix 1, species of sites. Okay, so this is regarding trade in endangered species. Okay, now lastly, recently India's proposal to include Great Indian Bustard, Asian Elephant, Bengal Floricon in Appendix 1 of CMS, Convention on Migratory Species, was accepted during 13th Conference of Parties to this CMS that was held in Gandhinagar in February 2020. The mascot of this Conference of Party was this Great Indian Bustard itself. At that time, it was very much in news, and that's why you can see the question was also asked in prelims examination, in UPSC prelims examination. So this is how you need to take context from the current affairs. They will ask basic question, but the context is from current affairs. Okay, now finally, Richard Branson takes off first in space tourism race. Okay, so here recently, the entrepreneur Richard Branson with his company Virgin Galactic Space. Okay, so Virgin Galactic company, he with age of 71 years old and 5 crewmates, they had successful space journey, and in those 5 crewmates, there was Indian origin aeronautical engineer Shirisha Banla. She is the third Indian origin women to travel in the space after Kalpana Chawla and Sunita Williams. There is only one Indian to travel in the space up till now, Wing Commander Rakesh Sharma, only Indian citizen to travel in the space. Okay, then after this, there is going to be Mr. Bates, Blue Origin company. So yes, Amazon head who recently resigned, he is also going to travel in the space after 10 days now. Okay, so this is how the new area in space science or space technology, that is space tourism, this is going to be the future. Space tourism, because this Virgin Galactic company is going to open the space tourism from next year, and already 600 people as a space tourist have enrolled for that. So this is how it is going to be the next industry, economic industry. Okay, yes, everyone should or obviously will want to go into the space and watch our Earth from the space. This is going to be a beautiful sight, surely, but that is going to be the costly one also, right? You can see here the cost, initial cost, $2,50,000 for space travel. Okay, so Dhami holds off the Kanwar Yatra decision. So this is regarding Kanwar Yatra culture aspect. Annual pilgrimage of devotees of Shiva known as Kanwariyas from Bihar. These Kanwariyas walk hundreds of miles from Haridwar, Gomukh and Gangotri in Uttarakhand and Sultan Ganj in Bihar to their residences, carrying Ganga water on their shoulders. Okay, so Kanwariyas Yatras, you can Google it, you can watch the images. Last year it was cancelled due to pandemic. This year the decision is not yet taken. Okay, yes. Now, COVID-19 related development, yesterday there was one article, Cuba has developed a conjugate vaccine for COVID-19. Along with that, one more vaccine that is developed. Names of the vaccines, they are Soberana 2, which has efficacy of 91.2%, and Abdala, this is having efficacy of 92.8%. This Soberana 2 is, the spike protein is chemically linked to the tetanus toxoid, making it a conjugate vaccine. Now, what is conjugate vaccine? You should be aware about this for prelims examination. Conjugate vaccine is having the vaccine dedicated for two diseases or two or more diseases. Okay. So, simply here for COVID-19 and tetanus, this tetanus is also attached to this, and now it is going to create antibodies or some kind of mechanism against the diseases for both. Okay, so conjugate vaccine, Soberana 2, Cuba country. At the same time, design and manufacturing of these both vaccines is such that they can be stored in regular refrigeration setting of 2 to 8 degrees Celsius, like Indian vaccines. You should be aware that Pfizer and Moderna, they require the temperatures less than 0 degrees Celsius for their storage. There was one article in yesterday's newspaper in Science and Technology page regarding Millennium Technology Prize 2020. For prelims examination, this in prelims pointer you can note down. Millennium Technology Prize 2020 is announced by Republic of Finland. Finland country, along with top Finnish academic institutions and industries. So, this 2020 award went to Shankar Balasubramanyam and David Nenarman for their development of revolutionary DNA sequencing techniques. DNA sequencing techniques. Now, you tell me why it is very important, DNA sequencing techniques in recent times. For COVID-19 sequencing of different variants, viruses. Okay, so the variants are evolving, and for that purpose DNA sequencing is being done so as to understand the evolution of virus, how it is happening, right?
Sir,
yes.
Sir, this technology is going to be useful for to find out the different viral diseases on the
Yes, yes. In future also it is going to be helpful. The different models being developed on the basis of this technology, it is going to reduce the time limit also, and it is also going to help at the faster rate the different kind of variants being evolved of this COVID-19 in at the world level. And that information can be shared among the scientists for further development of drugs and vaccines against these new variants. Okay, now, so quickly answer these questions because these are straightforward questions. Yes, other students? Yes. Krishna Raja Sagar is built across Kaveri River in Karnataka. Rather, Nagarjun Sagar Dam is built across Krishna River. Right? Nagarjun Sagar Dam along the border of Telangana and Andhra Pradesh. It is. Yes. Yes, yes. Answer should be A here. Nagarjun Sagar is built across Krishna River. Fine? Remaining are built across Kaveri River. This question, this is simple. Yes, yes. Mekeda 2 project in Karnataka, it is being proposed to be built across Kaveri River. Yes, Kanchenjunga is that biosphere reserve with variety of altitudes, and that's why different types of vegetation. Okay, yes, yes. So these were important articles from yesterday's and today's The Hindu newspaper. Try to take input especially for prelims examination, because Sunday's newspaper is more relevant for prelims examination. Okay, fine. Any question?
Sir, I have one question.
Yes, tell me.
Sir, every day, to be explained in newspaper now. So I think we need to go and write our notes somewhere. But if we're talking, sir, we need to take the papers and something.
Yes, if you are making notes for mains examination, that is good thing. If you are making for prelims related notes, that is not required. If you are reading these PDFs on daily basis, if you are having these PDFs and preparing for or we can say you are tech savvy and read everything from computer, laptop or mobile, then that is not a problem. Many students actually write down in their handwriting and they use to they revise those notes. So for them it is advisable to make notes. So yes, time management is important, but what happens is making notes is not let's say always wasteful activity. Whenever you are making notes, no, you are writing something. When you are writing something, you are revising in your mind while writing also, okay. And whatever you write in with your own hands, you sometimes add your own information also from other resources. You may not be able to add further information in those PDFs also, right? So it is advisable, but for prelims, this information is sufficient. For mains examination, we are doing analysis in classroom. You can make notes from mains examination. Okay, fine?
Thank you.
Okay, yes. So let us stop. We will meet tomorrow at same time. Thank you.
Contact us to avail the combo offer of General Studies and Public Administration optional with 20% discount.